I will be reading Matthew 6, verses 31 through 34. So don't worry about these things, saying, what will we eat? What will we drink? What will we wear? These things dominate the thoughts of the unbelievers, but you are heavenly. Your heavenly Father already knows what you need. Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. So don't worry about tomorrow, for today's troubles is enough.
Be seated, please.
Good morning. Glad to see everybody here with us today.
A week in the sun, a lot of unusually tan people here today, but that's okay. Hope that everybody had a good time. I know there was some cloudy weather in Florida, and you will get no sympathy from us that we're here in LJ all week. It is supposed to be a nice day today, weather warming up, and so we're certainly glad to see springtime. Lots of things coming up really quickly here for us as a church. Of course, Lads the Leaders right around the corner. I know there's a group that'll be staying today to work on some things. Convention just around the corner, Easter weekend, so we're excited about that. Also, of course, on the 28th, and you should have seen a lot of advertisements around the building, is our Friends and Family Day. So please be getting ready for our Friends and Family Day on the 28th. And then starting on the 29th and lasting until May 1st is the Reach North Georgia campaign. We filmed a commercial here on Friday for that you should start seeing this week on television, social media, and things like that. Please be inviting people. Please go and pre-register for that. We need to get an accurate number in the next week or so we can begin to order food and make preparations, but lots of things around the corner. In anticipation of that, at 5 o'clock this afternoon, we are going to have a prayer service. So everybody's invited. Among the things that we'll be praying for will be this campaign and some of the other things. So 5 o'clock this afternoon, a prayer service, and we hope that you will all be here with us. Being a parent changes the things you think about and the way you look at things. Sawyer and Jolie expecting a little boy right around the corner. I watched their gender reveal video, and Sawyer, I thought you had a better swing than that with a baseball bat. That's okay, we'll get to that later. But they're expecting a child just around the corner, and it's so exciting, such an exciting time in life. But things change very rapidly, and most of you have been through that and understand that. And when you're a preacher, you're not immune to that. And so there is this new thing that dominates my life called Disney. Mickey Mouse and all those things that even a seven-month-old really, really loves. And Mila's favorite song comes from The Lion King, and it's sung by Timon and Pumbaa, and it's called Hakuna Matata. And as I was thinking about this lesson this morning, this song just kept playing in my mind, and really because it plays in my mind all day, every day now, but it's taken from a Swahili phrase that means something similar to no worries. And you all know the song and how it goes, and most of you are hearing it in your head right now. And so it means no worries for the rest of your days. You can just sort of go wherever you want to and make your home there, and things will be wonderful, and there's nothing to worry about in life. And if you can be, you know, just a meerkat and a warthog, things will be great. Now, don't let this fool you. Warthogs don't have easy lives. Ken Bailey has one up on his wall in his trophy room. I know it didn't have a good life, but warthogs are mean animals. And so the things that we see on TV are not necessarily true. But when I think about this song, it really, I don't know about you, but it makes me a little bit envious to be able to go. And it says, you know, your home is where your rump rests, right? And you can be wherever you want to be. That can be your home, and life can be easy and wonderful and no responsibilities. Hakuna Matata. And then I read this passage that Quinn read for us a minute ago from Matthew chapter 6. It says, well, we could really start in verse 25. Therefore, I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air, for they neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? Which of you, by worrying, can add one cubit to his stature? So why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field and how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, and yet I say to you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Now, if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more than clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For after all these things the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things, and sufficient for the day is its own trouble. And so, the Bible almost echoes the advice of Timon and Pumbaa there, doesn't it? Where it says that don't worry because today has its own trouble and God will take care of you. Be not dismayed, whate'er betide, God will take care of you. And so it seems that as Christians, we should live this life where we don't worry and we're happy all the time and things are just great and we don't have these concerns and that's what a Christian life should be like. But let me pose this question to you. Is that what your life feels like? Because I want to stand before you this morning and tell you as I deliver this message to you, that's not what my life feels like. Because the truth is we have worries and we have stresses and we have troubles and we have this thing called anxiety that we deal with, that things that we struggle with. And I believe that sometimes we feel like that we're bad Christians if we struggle with these things. We hear those words, ye of little faith, and we think, man, it must be talking about me because I have worry and stress. I want to tell you, the only thing that worry and stress and anxiety make us is a human being. And we're not second-class Christians because we have struggles and because we have worries. It just makes us human. And so this morning, I don't want us to get to Hakuna Matata. I don't want us to think that somehow that's what we're supposed to be, because that's not how life works. What I want us to figure out is how we as Christians can figure out and learn how to manage these difficulties that come our way so that we can put our faith and trust in God to say when we have these struggles that we do know that he is in control. And I know as we're sitting here this morning that there are some of you that are overtaken in anxiety and struggle and worry. And I want you to know you are not alone. I almost feel hypocritical this morning preaching this lesson because with all the things that are on my mind and my heart and things that are coming my way and all the responsibilities and struggles and all the things that we deal with, I feel sometimes like it's overwhelming. I know you do as well. How many of us lay awake at night and just think about the things that are coming our way? Our jobs or our finances and how there's always somebody that has their hand out wanting money. Or how our health is failing, especially as people get older. You know, there are those health concerns. And have a doctor's appointment upcoming, and what's the doctor going to say? And the truth is, at any point, we could go to a normal doctor's appointment, and they could say, I'm a little concerned about this suspicious abnormality that came up on your test. And we worry about that. We worry in our relationships. Is my husband or is my wife, are they happy in our lives? Or even those who are single, they wonder, am I ever going to find anybody? These are real concerns and cares that we all battle and we all deal with. And we've got to figure out how to not say Hakuna Matata, no worries, but how to get to the point where we say, God, I know that this world is difficult. I know it's hard, but I trust you to be in control. We've got to figure out how to do that. Lest you somehow feel that you're alone in your struggles, I want to share some statistics with you about anxiety and depression. And by the way, let me make this clear. I think there's always been a certain stigma associated with mental health, not only in our country, but in the church in general. And even more than that, it's something that we joke about. I promise the elders, I wasn't going to tell this joke this morning because it's kind of corny, but I'm going to tell it anyway. There was a man who went to visit his psychiatrist, and he he told his psychiatrist, he said, "Doc, I've had some really strange dreams that I'd like for you to interpret for me." He said, "Two nights ago, I dreamed that I was a pup tent." He said, "It was really strange." And he said, "Then last night I had a dream and I was a teepee." He said, "Can you tell me what that means?" And the doctor said, "Of course I can. Two tents." You'll get that in a second. But it's been something that we sort of joke about and we struggle with, and we say, you know, I must not be good enough, or I'm the only one. Listen to these statistics. Anxiety disorders are the most common mental illness in the United States, affecting 40 million adults age 18 or older, or 18.1% of the population every single year. Here's what's even worse. Anxiety disorders are highly treatable, yet only 36.9% of those suffering ever seek treatment. There's so many of these that we could go and look down some of the specific things. Social anxiety disorder affects 15 million adults, or 6.8% of the population. And so if you're sitting in a room this morning, you're saying, "I feel uncomfortable with this crowd," you're not alone. There's a great many of the population that feel that way. There are people that deal with phobias, obsessive compulsive disorder, post-traumatic stress disorder. 7.7 million adults in the United States suffer from post-traumatic stress disorder. As we think about some of the other things that are faced, we just see that life is incredibly difficult, and there's all these things that we face. And so before we even get to the rest of this, I want you to know that if you are suffering in any way, seek out some help. One of the best things that we've done in my time here at the church is that we have brought on Phoebe as a counselor to be part of our staff. And she comes once a month, and it just gives people an opportunity to talk to her and get coping skills. And so if you feel like that you're overtaken by anxiety and worry and struggle, make an appointment so you can share some of those things with her and she can provide you those skills. But a lot of us deal with, I think, maybe something that's not clinical, but just this feeling of anxiety and struggle. And so this morning, I want us to kind of dig through together just four ways that we can try to battle this, that we can deal with it. Four things we can do to relieve some of the stress and some of the anxiety in our lives. And I'm going to put the list up here. We'll go through them one at a time. Number one, don't dwell on things that are beyond our control. We cannot dwell on things that are beyond our control. And let me preface that with this. There are a lot of problems that we cause ourselves. If you have a fixed budget and you go and spend all of your money on wasteful things and video games and things that have no need, and then at the end of the month you say, "Oh, I've got this anxiety because now it's time to pay bills," those are things that are brought on. And so there are things, I think, in life that we can do to prevent things. There are things that are part of things that we can control. And so I hope we'll deal with the things that we can deal with. Sometimes anxiety can lead to inactivity and us not doing the things that we can control. So we have to do the things we can control. But there are a lot of things that are beyond our control. For instance, if we go and we're told in a doctor's office that we have cancer, there's no amount of worrying or stress or anxiety that can magically make that go away. There are things that we can control, and there is medical treatment, and there are all those options out there for us, but us just sitting there and worrying can do nothing. It is beyond our control. The way that other people feel about us is beyond our control. We can just say, "You know, I'm just so worried that I might do something and somebody might not like that, and I'll have this reputation," and that's beyond our control. Don't worry about it. The psalmist wrote, "Don't fret. It only causes harm." And so sometimes there are things that we have to not worry about. That word fret is an interesting word. It actually comes from an old English word that has to do with something eating or tearing it. It means to gnaw. If you have a dog and you give a dog a bone, how that dog will just, even when there's nothing left and no taste and no flavor, that dog will just continue to gnaw on that bone until there's nothing left. That's what that word fret means. And isn't that what stress does to us? It's that dull pain that repeatedly gnaws at us and just gets at us over and over again. The Bible says, don't fret, it only causes harm. And so that's what we've got to do, I believe, at the beginning, is just don't dwell on things that are beyond our control. There are too many things that we can control to let the things beyond our control dominate our lives. And so that's the first one. The second one, let the past go. Let the past go. I'm going to tell you, this is probably the most difficult thing on our list. We've made mistakes that we dwell on. Even though we can't go back and change them, even though there's no time machine, even though we wish we could, there are just things in our past, mistakes we've made, hurts that we just cannot let go. There's nothing that we can do about them. There's nothing we can do to change them. There's nothing we can do to fix them. We've got to let them go. Paul, we're going to look at some things that he said in a minute in the book of Philippians, and he talked throughout that letter to the Philippian church about his past. He had persecuted Christians. He'd been just a terrible person. And he said, but I take those things from the past and I put them behind me and I press forward. He says, I've left those things in the past and I move forward. I'm not saying we forget that they ever existed. I think there is tremendous value in learning lessons from our past, but there is no value in just clinging to those things when we can't change them. So we got to let the past go. Whether it's clinging to something that somebody has done to us or clinging to something that we've done to somebody else, all we can do moving forward is be who God wants us to be. And so there's no point in just hanging on to those things and letting them gnaw at us. Number three, and this may seem a little cheesy to some of you, I don't know, but give yourself a break. Give yourself a break. And I'm talking to myself more than maybe I'm talking to you guys this morning, but we are so incredibly hard on ourselves. Whether it's some outside influence that's made it this way, or whether it's just us, we are so hard on ourselves, and we've set almost an impossible standard. You know, if you go through and you look at the research, the United States is the most anxiety and depression-ridden country in the world. People that live in third world countries don't have hardly any stress in their lives, yet we're here in the United States where we have everything. Brother Curtis mentioned, you know, how blessed we are as a nation, and yet we're the most stressed out people in the world. I think there was a famous philosopher in the early 90s who said, "Mo money, mo problems," right? That's that because of all the things that we're after and all the things we see in media and all the wealth and all the abundance and all the perceived perfection that we see, that we just have this standard for ourselves that we've set. And then if we ever fall short of that, if we're ever perceived as less than somebody else, if there's ever an area where we fail, it just consumes us. But none of us are perfect. None of us have the ability to never fail, to never mess up. And so when we do fall short, we've got to give ourselves a break. That doesn't mean that we never learn from anything. That doesn't mean that we don't grow, but I think we've got to give ourselves a break from time to time. And then finally, and here's where we're going to spend the rest of our time this morning, we've got to give it to God. Turn over to Philippians 4 with me. We talked about the derivation of the word fret a minute ago. Similarly, the word anxiety comes from an interesting place. It comes from Latin, and it's really a combination of two Latin words, and one of them means to strangle. And that's kind of how I think about anxiety, that anxiety has a stranglehold on us. If you've ever been involved in wrestling or done any training for things like MMA, if you're crazy enough to do that, if you've ever been in a good headlock from somebody and had the air leave out of you where you couldn't breathe, or if you are somebody who is claustrophobic and you've been in a situation where you felt like that you were strangling or suffocating and you couldn't breathe, when we live with anxiety, that's how it feels all the time. Like we can't catch our breath. And the physical symptoms of this are just as real as the mental ones. And that it causes that shortness of breath and heart palpitations and sweaty palms. And almost every single part of our body is affected by anxiety because it has a stranglehold on us. And so here's what the Bible says. When that anxiety and that stress has got a stranglehold on us, it says this, starting in verse 4 of Philippians 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Now, Paul, who probably is full of anxiety at this point, is actually in prison in Rome or something like house arrest. And he's there and he could be executed. He doesn't know what his future holds. He should, of all people, have all this stress on him. And he says, what? Rejoice. And he doesn't just say it once, he says it twice. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. He says, be happy, understand the blessings you have, celebrate what you've got going on in your life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Let your gentleness, verse 5, be known to all men, for the Lord is at hand. Be anxious, and there's our word, for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Peter said something similar. He said, cast all your cares on him because he cares for you. Jesus Christ bore our sins on the cross. He also bore our anxieties and our stresses and our worries. And so we've got to give those things to him. I want to wrap up here by looking at a passage in Luke 22, if you'll turn over your Bible there. One thing I always hate in a sermon is when somebody tells me what to do and then doesn't explain how to do it. So we said, give it to God. We said, cast our cares upon him because he cares for us. We said, with prayer and supplication, let our requests be made known to God and he'll give us that peace. I think that's part of the mechanism. But we've said this year that our theme as a body of believers is walking in the steps of Jesus. And I want to show you how Jesus dealt with anxiety. In Luke chapter 22, starting in verse 39. Coming out, he went to the Mount of Olives as he was accustomed, and his disciples followed him. And when he came to the place, he said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. And then an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him, and being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. We think that we've been stressed, and many of us have. Some of you have been through things that I cannot ever even comprehend how you deal with them. As I look out in this crowd, I see people that right now, although everybody around you may not know it, I know what you're going through. I know the struggles that you feel. I know the pain that you're going through. But I don't think any of us have ever been so stressed that the capillaries in our forehead busted and we were able to sweat blood. But that's what Jesus did. I think it was probably the inevitability of it all that caused him to go through that. But then, I don't know, this is hard for me to understand. In verse 45, and when he rose up from prayer and had come to his disciples, he found them sleeping from sorrow. And then he said to them, why do you sleep? Rise and pray lest you enter into temptation. I can't imagine just standing there knowing what I'm about to go through and the people that are supposed to be closest to me in this world are asleep. This to me would have been the time for table turning Jesus. What about you? To go and just give them a swift kick in the behind and say, wake up, do you know what's going on? Do you know what I'm about to go through? Do you know that the entirety of humanity rests upon the events that are about to unfold before you and you're laying there asleep? Yet he doesn't. He just says, get up and pray. So how can Jesus be this calm? How can he kneel down and pray with the sweat like blood in his eyes and in his mouth and going down his face? How can he look at them and be so calm? How can he go to the cross with all this? How can he take this anxiety about knowing that he's about to die the most brutal death in the history of mankind? How? Look at verse 42. Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Here's what I know. I know who's in control. We sing a song sometimes that says, I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand. That come what may, God is in control of this world and his will is going to be done in every situation. And if his will is for me to die of some disease and enter into my reward at an early age, not my will, but yours be done. If his will is for me to live to be 95 years old, not my will, but yours be done. Jesus said, Lord, if your will is for me to bear this cup, to go to the cross, then Lord, not my will, but yours be done. Let me ask us, when is the last time that we knelt down and prayed, Lord, not my will, but yours be done? Paul wrote to the Thessalonian church, he said, we don't want you to be ignorant concerning these things in 1 Thessalonians 4:13. He said, for we do not sorrow like the world. Or some versions say, we do not sorrow like those who have no hope. Because we know that at the end of the day, God's will is going to be done. And God's will is for us to spend eternity with him. And I want to tell you this morning, some of us are going to die horrible deaths. Some of us are going to leave this world young. Some of us are going to leave it old. Some of us are going to go through pain and struggles. And some of us are going to go through difficulty. And some of us are going to struggle with finances. And some of us are going to have broken relationships. Some of us are going to have any variety of difficulties and hardships in our lives. But ultimately, God's will be done. And his will is for us to be with him forever if we're willing to obey what he says. So how do I give it to God? I say, God, let your will be done. And so when you're laying there at night and you have a struggle, an anxiety, and a worry, if it's something you can't control, let it go. If it's something from the past, let it go. Give everything and anything to God. We have this list of all these things that are struggles and difficulties and hardships. But the beauty is, the victory's already been won. Jesus Christ gave his life on the cross so that we could leave those things behind. Now this morning, if you're struggling with some worry or some anxiety, please don't feel like that you're lesser than anybody else, that you're less than anybody else, or that you have a harder time, or that you're alone. Every one of us in here has felt the difficulties of stress and anxiety and worry. Hakuna Matata is not a real thing. None of us can go into a Disney movie and walk around and eat bugs and live that way. We have to abide by the rules of this world. If you struggle, you're not a person of little faith. That's not what Jesus was saying there in the Sermon on the Mount. What he was trying to get us to understand is that God is in control and that through whatever means necessary, he'll care for us. So we don't stress and we don't worry like those people who have no hope, because our hope rests in Christ Jesus. And if you have something that you want to share with the church this morning, if you have some sin you want to repent of, if you have just a prayer request, then we're going to have an invitation song here in just a minute. We hope that you'll come forward and share that with us. And if you're not a Christian, you do have something to worry about. And I don't mean that to scare you, but there is no hope outside of the blood of Christ. And so if you need to contact that blood through baptism this morning, we have that prepared for you as well. Whatever your need is, come as we stand and as we sing.
Please be seated.